First, the overture.
You can't take the mask off. That's not what the movie's about.
Remember, remember the 5th of November.
He is about people.
Listen to me. Artists use lies to tell the truth.
We use fiction to convey truth, which is why we're so drawn to stories.
This may be the most important moment of your life. Commit to it.
I can't feel anything anymore.
He's doing what he's doing for the people who are oppressed, for the people who are subjugated, who are beaten, who are imprisoned, who are killed. And that's powerful.
Here comes the crescendo.
Welcome everyone to Cinema Therapy. I am smiling from ear to ear. My name is Alan Seawright. I'm a professional filmmaker who needs therapy.
I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves movies, and we are joined today
by a personal cinematic hero and god of mine, James McTeigue, the director of V for Vendetta, Ninja Assassin. Your CV, just, it blows me away, man. Tell us what you want to tell people about.
I started off as an assistant director in the film industry, and I guess my entree to directing was, you know, I'd done a Star Wars movie, some Moulin Rouge, and I grew up in the Australian film industry, which was sort of low budget. Then American movies started coming to Australia, so I started working on those, and that eventually progressed to The Matrix. And after The Matrix trilogy, then I started directing films, and the first film I directed was V for Vendetta.
Yeah,
which I've got to say is an all-time classic. It is an absolutely incredible film and weirdly, disturbingly prescient.
Yeah, I was just telling Alan, I feel like it's even more relevant now than it was when it came out, which is saying something.
It's sad. It's saying something sad.
It's saying something very sad, so.
I'm going to try to rein it in, but this is mostly just going to be Jono talking about, like, useful stuff and me losing my
All right, sounds fun. Let's do this.
Voila! In view, a humble vaudevillian veteran, cast vicariously as both victim and villain by the vicissitudes of fate. This visage, no mere veneer of vanity, is a vestige of the vox populi, now vacant, vanished. However, this valorous visitation of a bygone vexation stands vivified and has vowed to vanquish
this
these venal and virulent...
speech is so much fun.
...safing the violently vicious and voracious violation of volition! The only verdict is vengeance, a vendetta, held as a votive, not in vain, for the value and veracity of such shall one day vindicate the vigilant and the virtuous. Verily, this vicious swaz of verbiage veers most verbose, so let me simply add that it's my very good honor to meet you, and you may call me V.
Are you like a crazy person?
Something I enjoy from a thematic standpoint and speaking to their relationship is his extended alliterative monologue. The first time you watch it, you're like Evie, and I like the cuts to her because she's the audience surrogate. She's just trying to follow all of it. and it is a little weird, and it's meant to be a little weird, and it's okay that it's weird because you have Evie being the grounded person saying, yeah, this is bizarre, okay. But once I get past how much of a kick and how fun it is, I'm actually listening to what he's saying. He's offering her his mission statement of who he is and what he's all about. And it's all there in two words, vaudeville and vox populi, right? Mm-hmm. He's all about the people and he's all about performance.
First of all, he's come to her rescue, and then she sees sort of quasi-violence, and then this kind of strange kind of dialogue, and then, like you were saying before, him giggling with his face down, like, how could you not, like, react like she does in this way?
Are you like a crazy person?
I think that's probably the only sane takeaway you could have at that point.
What a character introduction. One of the all-timers, and it's, you know, your direction, Hugo's performance, and that script by the sisters. Just absolute knockout. This episode is sponsored by Surfshark.
Surfshark is a VPN, a virtual private network.
It will veil your virtual visitations.
Yes, it will keep your identity and information safe and private online. You can also use it to change your virtual location.
You can vary your venue as viewed both visibly and virtually, whether in Venice, Vienna, Venezuela, or Versailles.
Uh-huh. you can still connect to all your favorite websites back home.
Surfshark vaults you vicariously to a variety of volumes across vicinities,
so we can watch more movies and TV shows from around the globe. Surfshark Alert is part of an add-on security combo that monitors your personal data, checks for potential breaches, and gives you real-time breach alerts.
It will verify the veracity of any verisimilar villainous voyeuristic visitations.
Surfshark encrypts your online data, covering up everything you do online.
Veiling your viewings with a veneer of vacancy.
You can get 24/7 support, and Surfshark has a 30-day money-back guarantee.
Value.
Verily.
Get Surfshark VPN at surfshark.deals/cinematherapy and enter code CINEMATHERAPY for a Black Friday special offer and 4 extra months for free, as well as 5 extra months for free with the Surfshark One package.
Voila!
I find you vexing.
Verily?
Our relationship is virulent.
I thought it vivacious.
I maced that detective. Why did I do that?
You did what you thought was right.
Oh no, I shouldn't have done that. I must have been out of my mind.
Or is that what you really think, or is that what they'd want you to think?
I think I should go.
May I ask where?
Natalie Portman does such a great job of
looking for you. If they know where you work, they
playing someone under control.
Well, I have friends. I could stay with them.
I'm afraid that won't work either. You have to understand, Evie, I didn't want this for either of us, but I couldn't see any other way. You were unconscious, and I had to make a decision. If I'd left you there, right now, you'd be in one of Creedy's interrogation cells. They'd imprison you, torture you, and, in all probability, kill you in the pursuit of finding me. After what you did, I couldn't let that happen, so I picked you up and carried you to the only place I knew you'd be safe. Here, to my home.
I won't tell anyone, I swear. You know you can trust me.
I'm sorry, but I can't take that risk.
But I don't even know where this is. We could be anywhere.
You know it's underground. You know the color of the stone. That'd be enough for a clever man.
What are you saying? That I have to stay here?
Only until I'm done. After the fifth, I no longer think it'll matter.
You mean a year from now? I have to stay here for a year.
Sorry, Evie. I didn't know what else to do.
You should have left me alone. Why didn't you just leave me alone?
Doing something for the good of another person against their will and without their consent generally is not okay. But here's the thing. If you look, but it's all about context, right?
Right.
Because what he's saying is, he shares that value. He shares the value of honoring people's free will and not doing things against people's consent.
Well, and he shows it at the end. I didn't know what to do. You can hear it in his voice. You can see it in the slump of his shoulders.
This was life or death. And it was either violate your free will because you weren't awake to consent to me taking you here, or let you be tortured and murdered. And so I decided, I went with the former.
The lesser of two evils.
Yeah, he's like, I don't love it, but I did what I did. And that makes total sense. But there's no way anyone comes away from this and just says, he's terrible and I hate him.
No, he's an empathetic character, ultimately, right? But it's, you're right, it's in the, you know, it's in the groundwork that you lay. And, you know, there's a lot of things going on in what you guys just actually touched on, right? Because it's like, it's an anti-superhero movie in a lot of ways, right? And he is about people. That's what we try to give you at the end of the movie. That's what the mask represents. He's himself, right? He's this sort of tortured, damaged, self-actualized human being, not to be too Maslow on it, but right, you know, that's what he,
yeah, go for it.
That's what he's like, you know, presenting himself as, right? He's doing it for the good of the people.
My father was a writer. You would have liked him. He used to say that artists use lies to tell the truth while politicians use them to cover the truth up.
A man after my own heart.
He always told the best stories. Until my brother died. That was when everything changed. My brother was one of the students at St. Mary's. After he died, my parents became political.
So, I'm curious how intentional you all were about she's opening herself up and really letting V in. And we find out right after this scene that all of it was an act just so that she could get away. And how much discussion was there on set with Natalie about that, for instance?
They would win. Win, like. It was a game.
Evie, quick, hide!
Thank you.
It was like those black bags erased them from the face of the earth.
I'm sorry, Evie.
No, I'm the one that's sorry. Sorry I'm not a stronger person. Sorry I'm not like my parents. I wish I was, but I'm not. I wish I wasn't afraid all the time, but I am.
How much discussion was there with Natalie about, like, you're playing this deeply emotional scene and it's true. She's using the truth to tell a lie while she's talking about using lies to tell the truth. It's just, it's so good.
Natalie's super bright. She read the script. She got the script. She knew exactly what was going on. We would joke with her because actors lie for a living, right? So it's an in-joke. But yes, she is manipulating him as much as he is manipulating her in this moment, right? Because her ultimate thing, that why she's giving him that story, is so she can get out of there. And she's using, you know, what happened to her, what happened to her parents, as a tool to make her escape, right? And I think that she fortifies herself before she walks in there, right? It's like, it's not something that is that she's always done, but she knows that that is one way that she can get out of there. So I think, yeah, Natalie was completely down with it. She really knew what was going on.
I think that's thematic throughout the film, is characters do what they need to do to survive.
Yeah.
Right? It's a thin line between manipulation and guiding someone. Because you could look at what a therapist does and say, there's a lot of manipulation going on there. And yes, we have such a negative connotation with that word that I don't want to call it manipulation.
Right.
But it is absolutely guiding people to unlock the areas of their heart and of their mind that they've kept locked. It is absolutely helping to shed light on something they haven't considered, or to see the consequences of their choices in ways that they are refusing to see. And how much we, not just therapists, but any of us can do that without using force or coercion or burning bridges. At the end of the day, you want them to make their own choices, but you also don't want them to run headlong into things that are going to lead them to ruin. And you have a responsibility, right?
Right. It gets into a discussion about what is fascism, why it operates, how it operates. Usually the fascist rule book is always like the same. It's fear of minority, fear of everything, just
of the other,
fear of immigration. Be, you know, like, and it's always the same thing, you know. And I woven into that is this, at the time, quite incendiary discussion on what's the morality of terrorism. Right?
Yeah, like, right.
People aren't born terrorists. Your set of circumstances leans you that way. When you feel like there's no way out, you know, when there's, you can't do anything else but resort to violence, right? And we were like giving you this very morally ambiguous character and saying, hey, well, you know, what made this guy? What maketh the man in that?
Gordon?
Could you hide?
Not so funny now, is it, funny man?
Watching this gives you a taste of what it's like without freedom of speech.
Yeah.
Something that we sometimes take for granted.
But also, like, I really wanted to focus on Evie being re-traumatized here. And how early on was the decision made to just mirror, you know, exactly what happened to her as a child is happening to her again?
Early on. It was in the script. We made a very deliberate decision to re-traumatize her in exactly the same way.
Yeah. And Jono, re-experiencing trauma, because a lot of people get traumatized and have PTSD, and they'll have PTSD flashbacks where they're mentally re-experiencing it. But what does it do to you to have it physically
start up again?
What character?
For a lot of people, it sets them back to square one, or if not square one, because they've gained some skills and some tools, it's still like, okay, I have to use those skills and tools that I've acquired because I've been reset, right? I've been reset with my trauma.
Yeah,
I'm more powerful now. But it doesn't mean I haven't gone back to square one and this is what I have to work through. If this keeps happening, it's going to turn into complex PTSD, where there is not a reprieve of this is in the past and now I'm dealing with it. It's my present and it's my future, and that's rough.
It's time.
I'm ready.
Look, all they want is one little piece of information. Just give them something, anything.
Thank you. But I'd rather die behind the chemical sheds.
Then you have no fear anymore. You're completely free.
So he tortured her for weeks.
Mm-hmm. Dunked her head in water. Count of Monte Cristo overtones like big time because it's one of his favorite books and favorite movies. She finds the story
written right on some toilet paper. Yeah.
Just like Edmond Dantes connects with somebody else and gets their story, and that gives him hope and gives him drive to continue on and assume that she's been in this horrible prison and it's a dummy at mm-hmm. the end of the hall, and she comes out and it's V, and he's like, surprise,
great job. As a therapist, is this a technique you would recommend?
Not if you don't. I would go to jail.
Okay.
Torturing and breaking somebody, he knows that she's been brainwashed.
Yes.
And he's effectively undoing it, right? And for it to work, she has to believe it's real. This is something that when we did our Twilight episodes, because this is art, Twilight is not, but in our Twilight episodes, people chimed in and they're like, you can't compare it to real life, it's werewolves and vampires, and I'm like, I can, but that's a different story. This works in this context, and yes. and she feels incredibly betrayed, and he knows that she's going to feel betrayed,
yeah.
And he hated doing all of this, and it still doesn't change the fact that it's icky.
Right.
But it's also like so many of V's actions, this is not who he wants to be, but it's also, this is his world. This is what he sees as his only choice. Now, whether or not it is or isn't is up for debate in the context of the story. In actual therapy, you need people's consent. They need to know what is happening, and they need to, yes, feel challenged to go to those dark places, confront their fears. Exposure therapy does that exact same thing. Mm-hmm. But then they need to be able to have a release and to feel safe. Right? And in therapy, you could do some pretty intense role-playing or some pretty intense, fantasizing about things. But there always has to be a place where, okay, is this too much? Should we back off? Mm-hmm. And V goes the opposite. So is this therapy? No. HIPAA would have a field day with this. Is it therapeutic? Yeah. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I'm saying it works. Like, it did work.
It did work.
I don't want to hear your lies.
Your own father said that artists use lies to tell the truth. Yes, I created a lie. But because you believed it, you found something true about yourself.
No.
What was true in that cell is just as true now. What you felt in there has nothing to do with me.
I can't feel anything anymore.
Don't run from it, Evie. You've been running all your life. Listen to me, Evie. This may be the most important moment of your life. Commit to it.
Okay. Most important of your life, commit to it. Have you ever had a client have basically a full-blown panic attack, and is that the right response to it?
You faced your death, Evie. You are calm. You're still. Try to feel now what you felt then.
So to answer your question, yes, I mean, panic attacks, or generally when people are facing their trauma or facing a truth that they are scared to face, or something that, this is kind of what therapy's been building towards, yeah. And we couldn't get there earlier because it would have been too much and you wouldn't have been able to handle it and you would have imploded. He is coaching her into, remember when you defied me, thinking I was somebody else, that you would rather die than give up this information or give up V. You had courage and you had this power, this fearlessness, tap into that now. Right. And so helping people to recognize their inner strength, and what he does is what I would do in therapy. I mean, I might breathe with them a little bit so that they're in a place of calm to hear me. Mm-hmm. But I think it's powerful. He's checking. As long as she's still hearing him, he's pushing forward.
Right.
Because if she's too overwhelmed and his words aren't registering,
it's just going to bounce off.
He needs to stop. Yeah. But that's not what's happening. So he keeps going because he knows he's pushing her to a breakthrough. Again, HIPAA would have a field day. I'm not saying this is especially the imprisonment, but what he's doing here is actually really powerful.
And part of it is those two actors like owning that. The first scene they ever did together, Natalie and Hugo, was that scene.
You're right? Kidding me.
Yeah. And whoa. I deliberately, he only came in like 2 days beforehand, but I deliberately kept them apart, right? And, you know, I was in this sort of like nervous state, like, is it going to work? Is Hugo going to be okay in the mask? And he came out and did that scene. And I'm like, I am saved. This guy just saved me.
Yeah.
They did an amazing job.
If you would like to see more of James McTeigue, you can on our Patreon, because there's an extended director's cut. It is significantly longer. Lots more details, behind the scenes stories, and fun. But this time, the apostrophe goes after the S. Directors. It's his, because he's in the cut. It's longer because he's a director. You get it. I'm sure you all were thinking about this on the set, that lies taught you a truth about yourself. Literally what we do for a living, right? We lie to tell ourselves truths.
Well, and we say lie because it's a powerful way to say it in the context of the story, but it's fiction, right?
It's a performance.
And we use fiction to convey truth, which is why we're so drawn to stories, is because we need them for our real lives. We need the cathartic emotional release. We need the insights. We need to be emotionally invested in somebody enough to go on the journey with them, but distance enough so that we can have real light bulb moments, because it's harder in our own lives because the emotion is just too much, right? And so we go on these journeys by proxy and learn with the characters what they're learning, and this is why we need stories.
She was real.
Yes.
She's beautiful. Did you know her?
Whose lesbian no. love story was
she wrote the letter
so crucial for Evie?
I delivered it to you as it had been delivered to me.
Then it really happened, didn't it?
Yes.
You were in the cell next to her. And that's what this is all about. You're getting back at them for what they did to her. And to you.
What was done to me created me.
And to millions of people like them.
Principle of the universe that every action will create an equal and opposing reaction.
Is that how you see it? Like an equation?
What was done to me was monstrous.
And they created a monster.
There she goes, she sees through him.
I love that he hangs his head a little bit.
Thank you. Goodbye.
He recreated his experience for her. And she thought, okay, this was all a lie. This was all a ruse to break me, to get me to not experience fear anymore. When he's actually, it's the brutal lesson in empathy of understanding not just what he went through, but why he's doing what he's doing, which is for the people who are oppressed, for the people who are subjugated, who are beaten, who are imprisoned, who are killed. And that's powerful, especially because the only reason that it's not weird or gross later on, that there's a little bit of romantic tension between them that only partially gets resolved, is because starting right here, she's no longer his student.
Right.
He is no longer a mentor. He has taught her what he learned, and they are on equal footing now. And when she leaves as a peer. And had there been any romantic anything before that in the movie, I would have called foul. But from here on out, it makes sense.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of roller coaster emotions happening in that scene too. She calls him a monster, and then within the next 30 seconds thinks about kissing him. She's free, but she's attached. She wants to get away. He calls her back and says, "Will you come back?" She's still not completely sorted out about him. You know, she's just like, oh my God. Like, she's just hanging on to everything that he has done to her.
Yeah.
But he's setting her free.
You cry the long
miss this song.
I didn't think you'd come.
I said I would.
Ah. You look well.
Thank you.
May I inquire as to how you've avoided detection?
I guess whatever you did to me worked better than I'd imagined.
I have a gift for you, Evie, but before I give it to you, I'd like to ask you something. Would you dance with me?
Now? On the eve of your revolution?
Oh, a revolution without dancing is a revolution not worth having.
I'd love to.
That's a great line.
You know, she, not in a super accusatory way, but says, whatever you did to me must have worked really well. And Hugo Weaving takes that small step back.
He hangs his head a little.
Like he's been punched. It's just, oh, every time, like the first time I watched that movie, I was just like, oh, what? Holy crap, that's acting. It was incredible.
It's also, again, one of the reasons you don't hate V.
Yeah.
Is because it's not like he is unfeeling about the whole thing.
Yeah.
He saw it as a necessary evil. And he regrets it every day because he never wanted, he doesn't want to hurt her, but he does want to protect her. And that's what he did to protect her.
Yeah. And, you know, I think also, too, it's the first time that she comes in with a completely different tone, right? Yeah. In the way that she talks to him.
Yeah.
She is now a different person. And whereas he was always on the offensive and she was on the defensive trying to work out what was going on. She has become the person that now V is a little bit on the defensive. I did what I said I would do.
Yeah.
Right? What you did to me must have changed something in me, right?
Yeah.
I'm glad you played that scene. I love that scene.
I don't understand.
What?
How you can be one of the most important things that has ever happened to me, and yet I know almost nothing about you. I don't know where you were born, who your parents were, if you had any brothers or sisters. I don't even know what you really look like.
Evie, please. There is a face beneath this mask, but it's not me. I'm no more that face than I am the muscles beneath it or the bones beneath them.
I understand.
Thank you.
You know, from here on out, there's
action and mayhem.
Action and mayhem, and then there's some more emotion, but it doesn't dramatically change what their relationship is. This is kind of, I think, where they get to. I'm sure there were discussions with the studio at some point, like, hey, do we get to take his mask off? And how did you guys deal with that? Because I assume from the very beginning it was, his mask never comes off.
No, and we said no, right? We just said that as soon as you take the mask off, right, that's not what the movie's about, right? I mean, it's, you can't take the mask off. So, no, I think they knew better than to ask the question. And it's funny that they didn't, because that is absolutely one note that you would usually get.
It's what stayed with me all the years after I saw the film and other details had faded away is the right of every person to live free and to love free. And ultimately, all of the cool action and all of the political intrigue and all of the questionable ethics, the backbone is people are meant to live free and love free, and that's what these two connect over, and that's why that relationship is so potent to both of us and to many, many viewers. So thank you very much, and thank you for joining us today.
Oh, yeah, it was an absolute pleasure, and I think it's as prescient as it was then as it is today.
So until next time,
view videos vigorously.
This show is brought to you by patrons on Patreon. People like
Nikki,
Charlotte Penn,
Traxathon,
Yaoki.
What? Yaoki. Oh my gosh, no, that is what it says.
That's what, yeah. I can read.
Anna Kempel. I thought for sure that you couldn't, and that was the problem.
Anna Kempel. Not Anna Kempel, I'm sure that was your problem. Anyway, you can go to our Patreon and you can get exclusive stuff like extended director's cuts and other things, and maybe we'll say your name or a word that you wrote.